welcome, everyone. Thank you very much for coming out in the slightly chilly weather. My name is Alyssa Goodman, and I'm the co-director for science here at the Radcliffe Institute. And so I welcome you also on behalf of Radcliffe. Some of you may have been here earlier this year for our annual last year, for our annual science symposium on the undiscovered. And the theme of the undiscovered, for those of you who were not here, has to do with not completely by accident or serendipitous scientific discoveries, but discoveries that are made when you have a plan for what kind of science you want to do, but then you find something you didn't exactly expect, but you are very prepared. And so Dan Kammen, who you're going to hear from today, will talk about that kind of work a bit in the context of energy research and potentially, hopefully, saving the Earth. And so it falls to me to tell you about Dan, which I will do in just a minute, but also to mention that there are two more talks coming up within a week in this series. So we have one on Friday and one on Monday, and they both have a life science bent, and the information is on the Radcliffe website. And so if you haven't registered for those, two more talks in the Undiscovered series, one Friday and one Monday. I should also mention that the first few rows here are filled with people. The reason I'm wearing a name tag today is that as another activity at Radcliffe, we're having a two-day seminar, small seminar, on trying to marry data science approaches and climate research across all fields: law, business, economics, earth science, health. And we'll let you know how that comes out, hopefully at another event in the future. But one of our participants for that is my friend Dan Kammen. And so Dan Kammen and I first met when we were both graduate students here in physics in the late 1980s. Dan looks younger than me though. But anyway, so Dan, like I said, we both got degrees in physics, and then Dan's path diverged fairly quickly, where he got more and more interested in energy and energy policy. So he has also an undergraduate degree in physics from Cornell, and then he went on and did postdocs at Caltech and came back to Harvard, and then he went to Princeton as an assistant professor. But for the last 20 years, he's been at UC Berkeley. And the list of titles that Dan has doesn't even fit on the page that I have in front of me, so I just selected some to give you some taste of what he does. He's currently the class of 1935 Distinguished Professor of Energy, the chair of the Energy and Resources Group there. He's also appointed in the Goldman School of Public Policy in the Department of Nuclear Engineering. He's the founding director of the Renewable and Appropriate Energy Laboratory, the co-director of the Berkeley Institute of the Environment, the director of the Transportation Sustainability Research Center. I left some off. He's very lazy, as you can see. And he's founded or is on the board of more than 10 companies. And some of you may remember his name from the newspapers and the news, because he has advised the Obama administration and the World Bank, and extremely briefly, the Trump administration, on energy and sustainability issues. He also was the coordinating lead author for one of the IPCC reports, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. And you may remember that Al Gore and the rest of the panel won the Nobel Prize for their work in 2007. So because Dan shared that prize with so many other authors in addition to Al Gore, who got half the prize, he told me I'm allowed to call him a micro Gore. So also, you may have seen Dan. When you see him, he might look familiar. He's been on many, many television programs, and in particular, he hosted a six-part series for the Discovery Channel called Ecoopolis. And so I'm going to stop taking Dan's time away and just say that I'm really excited to hear him tell us about an energy plan that the Earth can live with. And the plan is that we'll hear from Dan, and then we'll take questions at the end, and there'll be a microphone in the aisle. And when you'd like to ask a question, please do come to the microphone. And thank you very much, and thank you for coming, Dan.
Well, you used it. Well, thank you all for being here on what, for a now a Californian, feels like a very, very cold evening. So I really appreciate everyone getting here. I have to say, though, that I feel even more sort of attuned with the undiscovered path, because you can tell a fairly good story about what I've done afterwards, but at the time, you know, I came to Harvard to do cosmology. I actually transferred here. I won't get into that right now. But I got here, and then I got seduced into studying neuroscience and the evolution of the brain. And it's actually the complex systems part that I feel like has been the most useful in the work I've done. And I hope that that kind of appears as we go. But it's a story you can tell the ties afterwards, but I sure cannot tell a coherent story at the time. It was an interesting wander through a lot of very nice benevolent neglect along the way. And so right now we're at a point, though, when we need to do much more than benevolently neglect the planet. And so I'm hoping these will tie together a little bit. And what I'll try to do is to give a bit of an introduction to my laboratory, because the way that it functions is critical to the mixture between basic science, applied science, and engagement with a variety of non-governmental groups and governments and others along the way. And I'll use that to really look at how quickly the energy system of the world not only is changing, not always for the better, but the ways in which we critically need it to change. And so this is the part that will bore the experts in the room, and I apologize just a little bit. But really to use that to look at what are we learning about how to guide and steer innovation for a decarbonized world. And that's really what I get at. What I find exciting is that we, like all academics, say all hard problems we haven't solved, we are waiting for the younger generation to solve. And I do remember when I felt like I was one of those younger generation folks, which I do not anymore. And right now, we are at a point where the 15-year-old Swedish school children and young 29-year-old members of the US House of Representatives and a variety of others are absolutely doing exactly what we say in a very casual way, those sorts of changes. And so I'll end with this call for a just transition, which is probably a more accurate title than an energy plan that the world can live with, because it's not clear that the world is going to be too happy with the energy plans that we are creating. So I'll jump into our lab for a second just to give a feel for it. It's a quite a diverse group of individuals, lots of different backgrounds and interests, and it's quite international. It's really quite diverse, and so there's a lot of approaches. Most of the people that find their way to this energy and resources group came out of a STEM background, but increasingly we have people from philosophy and rhetoric and a variety of other areas as part of the mix. And it's been really heartwarming to see the number of people who feel like they have a huge input on how we think about energy innovation. And it's not just the kind of the material science and physics and chemistry world that I sort of assumed when I founded the lab would be the main pieces of it. So anything that I'll talk about today, the slides from today's talk, so the papers and things that I'll mention, the video clips, they're all available on the RAIL website, Renewable and Appropriate Energy Laboratory. And you do need to type into Google more than just RAIL, because if you just put in RAIL, you will get the RAILians who claim to have cloned a human 10 years ago in Florida. Haven't heard a lot from them since. So my name or Berkeley or something like that. And then the Twitter is not vacation pictures. We try to post about one tweet a day. Today was a bit heavy for reasons I'll get to in a little bit about the work from the laboratory. So RAIL has existed since I moved to Princeton, from Princeton to Berkeley 20 years ago. It's actually when John Holdren had departed here to Harvard. And so there was a spot available for a ex or former or something sort of physicist. So we've been working since. And the big project we worked on for the first couple years that Alyssa mentioned was that I'd been part of the IPCC team. It actually started when I was here at Harvard under a NIGEC, Northeast Regional Center for Climate Change Fellowship in the 80s. And then in the 90s, we worked really hard on a lot of the climate assessment, detection of climate change work. The big benefit was that we got this wonderful, got to share in the Nobel Peace Prize, which was wonderful. But I don't know how critical it is here at Harvard, but at Berkeley, getting the check is great, but as you know, if you're part of a big team, you don't get the Nobel Prize check. You get this nice plaque, but you do get something much more valuable at Berkeley, and that is a parking space with a big, large NL on it for Nobel laureate, and I was really waiting for my parking space to impress my friends and sort of annoy my enemies. Nothing happened the first year, 2007, 8, 9, nothing, nothing, nothing. Finally, a couple years ago, we said, oh, we're gonna act on this finally. At Berkeley, there were four members of the IPCC team. Inez Fung, Kirk Smith, Bill Collins were all part of the core team on campus and the Lawrence Berkeley Lab. And so we were told, yeah, you're about to get the award. You're going to get the parking space. And it's totally Berkeley, and they absolutely delivered what they said. We got a parking space. Nobel laureate bike parking, and you got to read the fine print. Parking not reserved for IPCC contributors. So the very few times I go there, there's like 16 student bikes in a huge heap. It looks like some sort of twisted metal thing from the Matrix, but it is very Berkeley specific, and so it's a Berkeley did us proud. Our lab is sort of generally thinking as interdisciplinary as possible as we can about climate issues, but we still come from a technical perspective. And so every now and then, our forays into, I'm not going to call it economics, I don't want to even claim that, but sort of financial engineering I would describe. And so one of the things that we came up with was a way to finance energy efficiency and renewables, something called PACE, Property Assessed Clean Energy. It's basically pirating the simplest idea out there that municipalities around the United States often lend money to property owners to underground transmission lines or repair sidewalks. And so we borrowed this idea, set up a company. 16 states passed laws to enable PACE financing, and it's worked relatively well, but it has a critical flaw, and that is to get municipal money to invest in renewables and efficiency, both things that make sense, you have to own property. And that means it is inherently a regressive policy. It borrows money from all of us to pay off those who are better off because they own something. And I'll come back at the end to the halting steps towards this just transition or an equitable, a socially equitable version of a change in this really critical problem. Since then, our lab has expanded the work we've done with governments around the world to help them think through how to do planning for an energy transition. And this has really been the most interesting feature for me. My kind of complex systems background, interest in basic material science, be it for new batteries or heat pumps or whatever the technology fuel cells is we're looking at the time, but it's really how to synthesize that into complex enough models, but also models that can be translated for work by governments, by nonprofit groups, by activist groups, by the private sector. And I'll give a few flavors of that as we go. And we've worked with a whole range of governments. I just put some flags of a few of them up there in places that have made interesting strides. And I should highlight that may not be obvious. We hear a lot about China, and I'll come back to China. And we have Mike Danielson and others in the room who have real expertise. But in terms of places like Kenya, you don't hear about. Kenya is, in some ways, the Silicon Valley of East Africa. Morocco is the only country that legitimately went to the climate conference this past December in Poland and were on target to meet their 2050 goals, the only country. And why it's in Africa, it's an interesting story. And Malaysia has a really interesting story around decentralized energy. So there are some really curious leaders emerging in this field. And that'll get me into kind of the core part of the talk, and that is we have to make this great energy transition, but we are moving too slowly. And the things that have caused some of the most interesting and most rapid progress, some of them are obvious, but I will do kind of a sort of a take on them. But even though I assume that no one here who came to this talk in the first place, who's in Cambridge, at Harvard, or MIT, and various places, needs any kind of a primer on climate change, but we all have somewhere in our family tree that crazy uncle or aunt who doesn't believe climate change and has 9,000 arguments that they'll trot out over Thanksgiving dinner until you pass out from tryptophan poisoning, and it's their argument why climate change isn't happening. And one of the interesting aspects of that is that the climate community on the science and engineering side is very dedicated to our models and our increasingly complex models. And while I'm as guilty as anyone, one of the challenges is to try to be able to encapsulate climate change in a model-free way. And you can look at a given heat wave or this or that, but you can always get someone and say, well, 80 years ago, 100 years ago, there was a similarly bad event. And so one thing that I use and urge anyone who has that sort of troublesome aunt or uncle in your family is a wonderful NASA, you can download this from the NASA website, and what it's going to show in, I think, 28 or seconds or so, is a series of synthetic images taken each point during one image per year when the sea ice over the North Pole hit its minimum. And that means it could be late August, early September, depending on that coldest moment. And so this is a critical part of the story, because these are simply images taken, no modeling involved. And what you're going to see is not only this, but a graph in millions of square kilometers showing the amount of ice. And so those of you who have watched Chasing Ice and now Chasing Coral, I hardly recommend both of those. But you see there's some fluctuations, but starting out in the late 80s, a little bit less than 7 million square kilometers of ice at its minimum in the late summer. There are some warmer years, colder years. I think I debated Bjorn Lomborg in 96 at a kind of a peak. But you see, we have, in a very steady, secular way, lost about 50% of the ice cover. And for those of you who have seen Chasing Ice know, very graphically, and it should make sense physically, you don't just lose area, you compact volume. So you're losing a dramatic amount of ice. And again, in a